Hi, and welcome to my talk on improving green mining for energy-aware software analysis. This was work primarily done by the undergrad researcher Stephen Romansky. He did this as part of his directed studies. He didn't want to come to Toronto, so I, Abram Hindle, his directed studies supervisor, am presenting it for him. This work is situated within the context of green mining. Green mining takes things like static analysis, dynamic analysis, tests, power measurements, and software changes, and integrates them into a corpus that relates all of these different kinds of tests and measurements with actual software changes. The intent of relating those things together is to reason about the energy consumption of source code changes based upon this corpus of power and energy regression tests. So, an example of a energy profile, that is, the kinds of measurements that we'd take from, say, Android Firefox, would be tests that were run across every single revision that we could run it across, and then power measurement of those tests. Some tests didn't have a lot of variance, some tests had lots of variance. You can see in this test that at the start there was a lot of variation in runtime behavior. It might have gotten worse power-wise, and then later, in the last quarter, it got a little better. So who cares about extracting the profile of a software application, the energy profile of a software application? Well, industry cares because they have to pay for data centers to run cloud machines and other kinds of servers. They also will manufacture mobile devices, and an efficient mobile device might attract consumers who want long battery life. Furthermore, reduction in resource usage is a sustainable practice and enables us to either use less or do more with the same amount. The benefits of this green mining is we can enable more efficient mobile apps, we can help produce more energy efficient software that, if it is run on a large amount of machines like Mozilla Firefox, can lead to large savings, as well as we can increase awareness in both users and programmers of energy consumption regressions. The plot that I showed back here, this plot, it was collected by measuring every revision we had that we could build on instrumented hardware. This hardware allows us to gather energy consumption readings while we run a test and will produce summary statistics. So basically, we feed in revisions into the test bed, and it measures the power use and associates that with every revision that we tested. The system that we use is the Green Miner. It consists of a separate power supply. We've got an Arduino to measure the power use. We got a Raspberry Pi to monitor and run the tests and load up the phone. And we've got a phone that's being tested. Unfortunately, the green mining methodology has a methodological bottleneck. That is, it is applied exhaustively to all revisions. So the plot on the side, we measured all the revisions we could. Furthermore, to get those measurements, we had to measure them multiple times, and we had to measure them for stability. Unfortunately, this takes a long time. This means if we measured each revision 10 times and we had 100 revisions, that we'd have 1,000 measurements. That's a lot of work if they're about a minute to 10 minutes apiece. So, with this methodological bottleneck of having to test every revision, our research question is, do we have to test every single revision? And what happens when we don't test every single revision? So, what are we going to try? We're going to try to test fewer revisions, and we're going to try to approximate the missing revisions. We're going to use a piecewise linear function to approximate. We're basically going to trade accuracy for time savings during data collection. And what we're going to try to do is try to maintain uniformity across the space by uniformly skipping a set number of revisions that we call neighbor distance. And this will ensure that we've got sort of equal coverage across the space while we're measuring it. So the neighbor distance means that we'll just test revisions that are multiple of our neighbor distance plus one. Each revision will be one neighbor distance away from the other revision tested, and this allows us to get uniformity. So in the bottom you can see blue, orange, blue, orange. Blue are the revisions we're going to test, orange are the revisions we're skipping. So a revision distance of one halves our work. A revision distance of two, as you can see, changes and makes our work a third of the revisions and makes two revisions be the distance between each tested revision. And for distance three, we can see here that this means that we've got three revisions between each tested revision, and we're testing a quarter of the total revisions. So we get revisions available for testing, we pick the revisions based on the neighbor distance, we choose the start and end ones, and then we approximate the values in between. The way this generally works is we'd start with the middle revisions after we measure the first revisions, and then approximate the other revisions, and then start testing other distance revisions and try to keep the distance between revisions to a minimum, and that would allow us to maintain good coverage and makes the algorithm sort of online. To evaluate if this algorithm, this neighbor distance algorithm, makes any sense at all, what we do is we measure it against the exhaustive green mining measurements. We take the root mean squared distance between the predicted model and the observed model, and we basically want it to be a low value, because that means there's not a lot of error involved in it. So the step one is we take a product and we identify a set of revisions that can be tested. We pick out the smaller set, the multiples of d plus one. We test and run at least two of the revisions from the smaller set, the start and end revisions that we picked, and then we interpolate in between. We approximate them using piecewise linear function between the first and the last one. And then we evaluate that approximation against the exhaustive one and measure the RMSD. And then we repeatedly pick the rest of the revisions and evaluate the exhaustive until none are left. So does this work? Well, we're going to test against multiple revisions, multiple applications, and test to see if it does work. We're going to simulate the neighbor distance algorithm on this data, and we're going to compare RMSD of the approximate profiles to the real profile. We've got two test applications. They each have more than 200 buildable revisions each, Firefox and Calculator. For Firefox, our tests are idle use and browsing a web page. For Calculator, it's simple equations, like GST calculations, things like that, quadratic. So the power profile of Firefox looks a lot like this, so quite a bit of variation over time. Definitely above 1 watt for the later versions. Calculator is different. It's got basically five distinct regions of performance, and its power performance is usually above 0.8 and usually about less than 0.85 watts. So we extracted those, and then with those extractions, we went and we looked at RMSD versus the test revision with varying neighbor distance. So this plot shows 20 different little plots. What each plot is a different neighbor distance. You can see that the plot at the top, the number one plot, has lots of points, and the plot at the bottom, 20, has very few points. That's because there are fewer points to test in a neighbor distance of 20, and there's a lot more in neighbor distance of 1. The x-axis is how many tests we do, and it's sort of the online result of the test. We can see that it takes a while for the neighbor distance of 1 to converge, while neighbor distances of 15 or greater converge very quickly. In general, the more revisions tested results in higher final accuracy, whereas the less revisions that we test results in lower final accuracy. But we can get pretty good results off the bat with the fewer number of revisions tested. Now, this result is relevant to search-based software engineering. Now, with search-based software engineering, we want to choose the best solution for given the constraint. So if we constrain against the number of revisions tested, basically the amount of time that we have to test, if we don't test a lot, we'll incur pretty heavy RMSDs. So relatively large ones, bigger than 10 milliwatts. If we use RMSD if we use a neighbor distance of 3 or less, we get a lot smaller armistice, less than 0.011 watts of armistice. Essentially, what this Pareto front shows us, where it's basically the best choices for each one, is that the less revisions that we test, the lower the final accuracy, and the more revisions we test, the higher the final accuracy. But in all cases, we make great savings for the smaller neighbor distances, the more revisions tested. We do half of the work that we'd have to using the exhaustive method with a small difference in RMSE. In the 2 area, we do a third of the work with a small distance in RMSE, and for the other zone, we do a third to a 20th of the work with a large difference, a much larger difference in RMSE, but it might be worthwhile if that amount doesn't really matter to us. So in general, time and accuracy are related, and positively related. The more time we put into this, the more accurate it gets. And what's neat about it is because it's an online method, we can choose to stop at just about any time. So a practitioner can trade accuracy for time of their, they can trade time for accuracy for their energy profile. Neighbor distances of 1 to 3 achieve about the best approximation of time savings, so we recommend about 1 to 3. You get good accuracy and good runtime. And you can see the savings in this chart. So we've got the neighbor distance along the one side. We've got 0 being the exhaustive model, and we're running each revision 10 times. So the neighbor distance of 1 for Android Firefox would take about 100 hours compared to 210 hours, whereas a neighbor distance of 2 would only take 70 hours. For calculator, a neighbor distance of 2 would be 1 day instead of 3 days. So these are significant reductions in time, and if you don't need exhaustive search, well, that's probably optimal. And what's really neat is that the neighbor distance of something like 20 is not a lot of time to actually extract. You could just take an extended lunch hour. So for future work, right, we want to know what makes a change impactful, what makes a disruptive change, and how can we identify these things and inject them into debugging tools to make it easier for developers to know when they've actually made a change. Furthermore, we had very simple models, and we would like models that would, maybe machine learning models that would predict discontinuities and when the system might actually change or where we should look for discontinuities. In conclusion, I introduced green mining. I mentioned that green mining combines testing with a corpus of results as well as power measurement. We talked about energy profiles, so we extracted the Android and the calculator energy profiles. Some of them changed over time, and we were worried that if we don't measure them all, we're going to get a bad energy profile. So we came up with an algorithm called neighbor distance, and we validated that we can trade off time for accuracy, and the amount of accuracy that we lose using this kind of time optimization is not very large, and it might be worthwhile for us to do this, so we don't necessarily have to be exhaustive in practice or in research. Essentially, the more time we want to spend on it, the better accuracy we're going to get, but whether or not that accuracy is much of a gain is questionable, especially after we max out with a neighbor distance of 3. There's not a gigantic gain from that point. All right, thank you for your time.